Welcome back. We're joined in the studio with engineer Hassan Shaaban, who is the former vice chairman of the Lwift Party. A pleasure to have you with us.
Thank you for inviting me. Appreciate it.
433 voted for the government program. Before I ask you about what you think of the program, what do you think of the parliament's progress, divisions, what have you, maybe the question that raises itself is, did you expect a majority vote for the
program? Yes, definitely.
You expected
it? Yes, since the end of the...
Even though we heard a lot of disapprovals over the past...
Yes. Since the formation of the parliament, I expected that anything that the government will present will have a majority. There is no doubt about that. The way the election ran and the results, the final results, actually indicated that anything that any government, not only this government, any government will present will receive a majority. So that was expected. Nothing really... unspecial about that.
The program is supposed to be designed with the constitution at the back of our minds, because we have, for the first time in the constitution, we have certain
clauses,
clauses that stipulate how you spend your money as well. I mean, there is a lot of emphasis on health and on education as the cornerstone of any reform in any society. Did you sense this present in the program?
Let me put it this way. The government that we have today is the same government that we had before the parliamentary elections.
Yes, and almost,
with a little bit of massage, you know, some touch up here and there, but it's the same. The issue is the governmental program, or the budget actually, was there for some time, and I think the members of the parliament could have had the time to review the budget closely. This budget should actually cast a shadow over the coming budget as well, because in the constitution, you are committed to spend a certain amount of your income over education and health, and reach a certain percentage by the end of like 3 years or something like that. You're going to spend about 10% of your income over education and health. The governmental actually budget did not really indicate how much we're spending per annum, per person, for health, for education. There is a lot of little details, but very important details.
You think this should have been included?
Yes, we need to know, because we need, if even the parliament approved the budget, I think there is a lot of homework that the parliament, as long as our representative of the people, representative, voted yes, they will bear the consequences of their approval of this budget in the coming 2 years. So this is phase one of the budget, and phase two will follow the next year. So we are committed to spend that much money for education and health. We did not achieve the required percentage, but it should lead to a better percentage in the coming year. I don't know if the members or the honorable members of the parliament had the time to go into details, because this constitution is gives a certain a lead time or a period for the government to reach the percentages indicated in the constitution from day one. The constitution admits that there is some weakness in our financial situation, so it's giving time to build and reach a happy ending by by 3 years. I don't know. I think the members of the parliament are carrying a big responsibility along with the government. There is some gaps in time schedules, when to accomplish what and how. There is a gap, and I think the budget should be divided into 4 quarters. Because in the first quarter, we're going to have to work very hard to bridge a certain gap in the finance of, there is a financial gap actually. The savings, the total amount of savings in Egypt is about 13.5%. And we needed about at least 20% to achieve a 5% growth every year. If we depend on the 13% amount of saving, we will not exceed 2.5% total growth. And this is very low, and it does not fulfill the dreams of and the hopes of our president. So the government will have to work very hard to bridge the gap, the financial gap, by loans, by aid, whatever it is, to boost up the 13% and make it reach 20%, so we could reach the 5% growth that we target.
If you look at, aside from the budget issue, if you look at what has been stipulated in the program to achieve in terms of economic reform, do you see it as tangible? Do you see it as feasible? Does it encompass what you as an Egyptian would want to do or would want to happen?
Unfortunately, this budget actually is not a budget that I was hoping to see. It's a traditional budget again, with the same outlines, nothing spectacular.
Even though it's supposed to conform to a constitution.
Yes, though it's barely coping with the constitution. Whomever actually put the budget together knew how to protect it from being unconstitutional. So it is a constitutional so far budget, but in the first quarter, there should be a lot of monitoring. Are we going to be able to bridge the gap that we have in order to reach the other, the period of the budget? I don't know. It's not really what I was hoping. I was hoping to see a realistic budget. I wanted to see a budget that cuts a lot of the expenditure in the governmental budget. I think austerity measures are not really considered in this budget. I would like to see the government cut on their spending, as a they should start with themselves. The government should start cutting, from their expenses, from their budget. I need to see something untraditional. Austerity is really what we really need right now. We are suffering from lack of foreign currency. The dollar is shooting up, and we need to do something to control all this. We need also to tie.
You don't think the measures adopted by the central bank will control, especially the issue of the dollar?
No, it will not.
You don't see it?
No, I don't. Full stop. And I'm willing to bet, because actually we need an income, a dollar income. First of all, we are not performing enough to produce, to cover the gap of importing foreign goods. Very simple. The agricultural sector is not producing enough. the industrial sector is suffering. So how can we actually just improve the international, the internal economical situation? So actually, we need ideas, not traditional ideas, to improve the situation in the agricultural sector and in the industrial sector. Mm. This is why a lot of people criticized projects like the New Capital, criticized a lot of projects that had nothing to do with the improving of the economical internal climate. Mm. I think we gonna see whether this government will be able to come up with you know, untraditional ideas later on, but this is a conventional budget, nothing really spectacular, and I was expecting a vote for the budget.
Mm. Let's hope our producer can get Senator Passant Fahmy on the phone. Maybe she can comment on the budgetary issues, since she's really a financial whiz, and how they regard when they approve the budget, how did they get it?
She's so an expert in that, yes.
Yes, if we can get Passant Fahmy on the phone to comment on this, this would be very good. Meanwhile, the Egyptian Prime Minister said that the program aims at addressing a very concerning issue, which is the issue of unemployment. And he said that in 2009-2010, the unemployment rate was 9%, which is right before mm-hmm. the revolution. And it jumped to 13.3% the last
3 years.
Over the last 3 years, specifically since in 2015-16, mm-hmm. the statistics mm-hmm. are 13.3, mm-hmm. which is a 4.3% mm-hmm. jump. Do you think we will be able to create with this program some kind of a mechanism to absorb the workforce, since he's talking about people in the 20s, I mean university graduates, laborers? Can we overcome such a catastrophe?
So far, actually, I did not see. I would love to see companies like the new Countryside that was formed recently, that uses massive amount of young people. We do not have to use sophisticated technology. We need to utilize our manpower. Mm. The average age of the Egyptians today is about 24 years old. And, you know, we have a lot of youth that could be utilized. Recycling of garbage and could be a good source of income. So far, I did not see a company that was formed to do this in the 27 governments. Actually, we need to utilize the young people in Egypt. Mm. So far, we are not creative. We did not come up with ideas that absorb all this manpower.
Mm. Some would say to absorb and create jobs, you need the money. You need to be able to pay those people. You need to produce. Is this a government responsibility or a private sector?
It's a private sector responsibility, actually. But actually, the government have the responsibility of improving the climate, the investment climate, mm. and create a trust relationship between the investors and the government. So actually, the government have to bear its share and improve the situation. Then the investors will, you know, have a lot of guts and get into the market with a better attitude. Everybody is standing still, watching what will government do, mm-hmm. actually, and when it comes to, you know, easing the tax situation, permits, and so forth.
Mm-hmm. The program also addresses another grave issue, which is the issue of national security. What do you think can be done on that realm?
Well, actually, things are almost wrapped up. I think I have a feeling that the government, the state actually have a firm grip on the mainland. What remains is the Sinai issue, and I think it will take us till the end of the year to finalize this, especially the political climate with Hamas is improving. There are certain commitments that Hamas have taken. And I think, you know, by the end of the year, the terrorism will be annihilated in Egypt.
Do you think the policies being taken will reduce our foreign debt? According to Sharif Ismail, our foreign debt rose from 33.7 billion in June of 2010 all the way to 48.29 billion as of January 2016, which is really catastrophic.
Yes.
Because you have a rise in foreign debt and a decrease in reserves.
Mm-hmm. Well, actually, I have a lot of doubts. How are we going to pay our debts? The interest on the debt itself is consuming a big portion of our income, and I think I don't know how. Not even in the budget, there is no good and clear formula. How are we going to pay our debt actually and control the debt itself? The 48 will still, you know, we're asking for new loans actually.
Well, you in your budget you have 75% allocated to salaries and 25% allocated to anything else, infrastructure development, services, what have you. Can we continue living the most of the budget just paying salaries and you're not producing that much?
Well, I think this is a main issue that the government will have to deal with, as well as the parliament, because you know, the parliament discussed earlier the civil servant law, and it was rejected just to have you know, or put touch-ups on the law to make it acceptable to the society. Let me put it this way. But again, I think we're going to have to deal very closely with the over-employed governmental system, actually. It's, we have a huge number of people.
Well, the civil law that was rejected, this was supposed to be addressing this issue,
yes,
in a way, and sort of evaluating the performance and cutting down on bureaucracy. And since this was not approved, then we're back to square one with this issue. And until something is done, some kind of a reform is done, then unfortunately it will continue to be a burden or a thorn at the back of the
government.
Actually,
I think there's some touch-up is being made on this particular law, and I think we're going to see a new copy or a new version of that law within a month's time presented to the parliament again. And we don't have any other choice but to approve it again. And whomever wants to survive in the government structure will have to work very hard to prove that he is he's capable of carrying the responsibility. Otherwise, a lot of people will have to change jobs and change careers.
Today, a question just came to mind that five of the members abstained from voting. Why? Because you're either for a program or against a program. I don't understand when you abstain, why you're abstaining.
Actually, I share with you this. I mean, it's, but it's more like, you know, vote against. You know, when you.
So why not vote against?
Somebody will should ask him this, actually. I really do not know why.
Just came to mind. I mean, either you're approving it or disapproving
Well, I don't know why are you in the parliament if you do not vote yay or nay. I mean, you just, you know what, nobody is watching you. You can state your mind and that's it. I'm against really not voting.
Do you think we have, before we continue with our discussion, we have with us Senator Mohammed Fouad, a member of the Egyptian parliament. Senator Fouad, can you hear us?
Yes, I can.
Sir, can you sort of shed light to us what happened today in today's confidence-giving session? It seems that the majority approved of the program.
Well, several things took place in the proceeding. First, they started with the continuation of speeches of representatives basically giving their evaluation of the program. Then it was the turn for the Prime Minister, Sharif Ismail, to give his assessment of what has taken place. Interesting enough, what has taken place also is the fact that today the Office of the Prime Minister has distributed to all the members of the Parliament an update of all the projects in all the governorates. Also, the Prime Minister has made an assessment of all the points which have been given during the past 2 weeks of speeches given by representatives. And then finally, it was the turn of the committee who had written the report for the evaluation to give its assessment, and finally it was the confidence voting. So this is basically what took place in this session today.
When the Parliament approved the budget, the government's budget, did it see it falling in accordance with what is being stipulated or what was stipulated in the Constitution? Because this is a concern.
We have not reached this battle yet, because what we looked upon is only the program. The budget has been received by the Parliament, but the budget is going to be discussed in the following weeks. So we have not gotten to the budget yet, and I think you're referring to the 10% of GDP in terms of the spending mandated for education as well as health services. But no, we have not reached this point yet, because budget has not yet been discussed.
So basically, what was approved today was the skeleton of a program.
It is the program, but it's not the financing part. The financing part, indeed, is going to come through the budget, and the budget will also add an additional story or sort of complement how we're going to answer the question, how is this program going to be financed?
Sir, can you tell us, even though the majority approved, but what were the major concerns that the Egyptian Parliament is concerned with in this program?
There were several concerns. I mean, some of the concerns were technical in terms of that the plan not elaborate on a lot of the timelines. For example, in terms of the major projects that were given into the plan, we have spoken of 9 projects, two of which were only a full study was available. There's also a lot of concerns that some of the economic targets that were given were not as aggressive as one wanted them to be. Over the public services, there are also concerns that the program was concerned rather with quantities rather than quality. For example, we talked about increasing cultural centers from 575 to 630, increasing schooling, but not a lot of emphasis given to the quality of education, the quality of cultural services, the quality of health services. So there's a lot of talks about expanding the capacity, but not expanding the quality of the private service. So these were the main highlights that we talked about by other members.
Sir, a final question. the issue of national security. Do you think this was addressed well in the program?
It was the first pillar of the program, and quite honestly, not a lot of members had anything to say about this except expressing a lot of support to the military, to the military, the Egyptian military, as well as to the Egyptian police in their continuing fight against any signs of terrorism. Mm.
Senator Mohammed Fouad, thank you very much for your fruitful input. Engineer Shaban, as we just heard, the details of the budget have still not been discussed. How do you feel about this? I mean, you were in one of the biggest parties, political parties in Egypt, and I know you had a shadow government. And how did you envision the whole process to work?
I'm not very comfortable, you know, how can I approve of a budget and don't know the how it consists, how it's broken down, how are we going to accomplish what's in the program. As I said, the parliament is now sharing the responsibility with the government. They voted yay, and I think the government or the parliament actually should form task groups to monitor the performance of each item or major item in the budget. Are they fulfilling what they promised? Did they spend that amount of money in the right way? We need to observe closely what the government is doing in the first quarter. And after that, the first quarter will give enough time to Sahar Nasr, the Minister of Foreign Cooperation,
yes,
to be able to come up with
national cooperation,
to come up with the required loans and to cover, as I said.
Do we need to continue on the loan method? I mean, do we need loans or do we need more BOTs? I want to see this X company, B company come and set up shop here and work. The issue of loans is only increasing, the 48.
Unfortunately, we're going to have to depend on loans for some time till the government comes up with a law for the investors to be able to come and invest in Egypt comfortably. Mm. And unless we do that, it will be a very difficult
issue. What about the Egyptian investor? I mean, we have one of the top 10 businessmen in Egypt in different sectors. And I mean, not just one businessman, but a number of leading businessmen recognized internationally and are really leading investors worldwide. Shouldn't they be given or involved more in a stronger role in economic reform?
Definitely. You see, we're not really working in full capacity. Hmm. We're just, you know, taking it easy, observing what the top of the country will do, the president and the government.
But you cannot continue in a democratic society. We have to change the idea that everything is up there in the president's hand and the president has to do everything. It's impossible.
The government is a little bit separated from the reality. Let me put, give you an example. Mm. Banks have a lot of money trapped in them. They don't know how to invest them. So they actually find it an easy way to give loans to people to buy cars. Mm. People buy cars. Mm. And uses a lot of the reserves in these banks in buying cars. And we suffer from a traffic problem. You see, so we're not really allowing the banks to invest in the right way. We need to direct investments. Mm. We need the Ministry of Industry to tell us what do we need. Do we, You know, we do not even produce pencils. We do not. We need to produce what we need. So far, the Ministry of Industry does not have a program to show to investors to cover a lot of the items that we actually import. Where is this program? I'm sure that once you put 1, 2, 3, I need 20 items this year to be covered, and next year I will do another 40 items. I think the only way is to make it known to investors what do we need, and give them a clear idea if they make money, how they can transfer their money outside Egypt, what is the method. I think also you're going to have to encourage major and large size companies in Egypt, like bonds, like in the Suez Canal issue. You're going to have to do one or two companies for agriculture. So far, the 1.5 million Faddans project requires a lot of study, and I think a lot of people would love to invest in it if it was a feasible investment. We need a lot of feasibility studies. We need to assure people that they will have returns on their money. We need to utilize the expertise in such projects. A lot of things are, you know, loose. They're not really, tied and well studied. So everybody is just wondering whether should we enter investment or should we wait. Egypt requires a lot of investments. We need. Let me just give you an example. You know, fishing have changed worldwide, meaning really you actually have a huge fleet in Domyata and in Alexandria and in Suez. These poor people go, you know, very far areas to fish, and most of them actually get trapped in the local authorities over there. But if you form a company and buy a huge used oil tanker and change it to a huge refrigerator and a factory to, you know, prepare fishing, and all these small ships will fish, and instead of coming back to the Egyptian ports, they go to the mother ship, wherever, in the Indian Ocean or maybe in the North Sea even.
Yes.
In the international waters, where actually fishing is very good. So really, what you need is to reach for the people. We need a huge fishing company. And this will improve, you know, the situation. Another thing, you know, when you actually talk about the 1.5 million Faddans trapped in the Ministry of Agriculture and the organization of invading desert, a lot of researchers on agriculture, cultivating land and agriculture using directly salt water from the sea without really desalination. And this is, you know, have been proven suitable for producing oil eatable by humans. You also could cooperate with Saudi, United Arab Emirates, because they're doing the same thing. We need to look to others. We need to tell them, come on, you actually perform this in your country, we like to do it in Egypt. Instead of just asking them to give us financial aid, why don't you ask them to come and apply what they've done in their own country in Egypt, and use young people of Egypt that are suffering from unemployment. A lot of ideas, but as I said, it's vision and imagination. We need imagination, feasible imagination, that you could actually apply. And use, you don't have to invent electricity if you can turn on the light. I mean, a lot of people are doing what I've just said. how to fish, how to actually cultivate land, you know, stuff like that. So as long as you are insisting to do things your way that did not really proven yet that it is the right way, you will suffer.
Before we wrap up, we have a couple of minutes left, and I cannot ignore that part and parcel of the government program is the Egyptian foreign policy. As we had started the show, really Egypt is the key to the...
Let me put it this way.
It's the transit stop.
Yeah, that is
To Africa, hopefully, and the Middle East now. How do you see our role, or how do you see the progress or the process of the Egyptian foreign policy now? And I see a smile which I haven't seen from the beginning of the show.
Well, I think our foreign policy is very much connected with our military capabilities. And I think our military capabilities are have proven that we were wise. We preserved our, you know, armed forces to bigger tasks. We still are the reserves for our friends in the Gulf. I think very soon we will see changes in the relations between the countries in the area. Saudi and Egypt are working on something. They're cooking something. Hopefully, Turkey will finally see the light and stop creating problems and criticizing our policies. We know better than others, and we know what do we need in Egypt. We maintained our country as one, and thanks to the our armed forces. We owe the armed forces a lot. In order for us to get into democracy and the rights of human rights, we need actually to annihilate terrorism. Then let's talk about anything else.
Engineer Hassan Chaban, as always, a pleasure to have you with us. Your ideas are very enlightening. Thank you very much for joining us on Daily Debate.
Thank you for inviting me.
I'd like to thank you, the viewers. Tomorrow, another day and another debate, and good night.